Well, a very good morning. Nice to be joining you here on The Leg Up. Voted New Zealand's number one show at the Thoroughbred Awards last weekend. No, just joking, but certainly is right up there. And thanks for everyone's support for The Leg Up. Thad Taylor, unfortunately, not with us this weekend. So running the cutter and looking after things. And we've still got the boys there in Paul Maoate and Stephen Hunt. First of all, Paulie, a very good morning to you.
Yeah, good morning, BP. Obviously, with no Thad, we've just lost our 61-75 demographic, but hopefully they'll be back next week. I'm reliably informed that Thad will be back next week, so he's not away for too long. And I love the jersey, BP. Up the Waz.
Thank you, Paul. Yes, up the Waz, 80 minutes away from the grand final. Who would believe? If we said that this time last year, Paul, wow, you would have been laughed off the set.
100%, never to return. So what a turnaround it's been for the New Zealand Warriors, and a big part of that, obviously, is the coach, Webby, Andrew Webster, who's done a mighty job with the boys that he's got, and the turnaround in form of Sean Johnson has just been phenomenal. So, yep, fingers crossed. Hopefully the boys can get the job done at Suncorp on Saturday night. We've got a big, big grand final to look forward to in a couple of weeks.
It won't be easy, that is for sure, but let's look forward to that on Saturday night. Stephen Hunt, we bring you in. And we think about last weekend, we had two good domestic race meetings out of New Plymouth and also from Riccarton. And that race at Riccarton, the Canterbury Bell Stakes, really lived up to expectations around those two fillies at the top of the market.
100% BP, good morning to you and viewers. Viva Vienna puts herself into conversation for the 1,000 guineas. I think she's low teens from memory in the futures markets, has been well supported, decent syndicate involved out of the Tiakau barn, Viva Vienna, and probably the only question mark leading into that race in a few weeks' time or early stages of November is whether she can stretch it out to 1,600 metres. But she's with the right camp. I reckon it was a funny day. I did my database and reviewed the meeting 40-odd hours after the actual meeting on Saturday, and the first six races all rated in terms of a speed rating well below par. And then come race seven, Chala comes along over 1,200 metres down the chute with a tailwind and breaks the track record. So it was a funny old meeting. I think conversely, those bend races, 14, 16 and beyond, faced a head-on wind down the back straight, which made those races up to the 600 very slow in terms of tempo, and then they've sprinted home. So it was a tricky day when assessing the races going forward, but obviously Viva Vienna and also Shallow were one of the two of the standouts for that particular meeting. I thought Mustang Valley was really good, Paul, up at New Plymouth at the Naki. She was the horse to beat. She brought the right form lines. And I think credit goes to Andrew Forsman and the team, because there would have been temptation to run in the Tarzino on the back of a very solid run in the Foxbridge a few weeks prior to the Tarzino, but it just wasn't the right setup for her. It was a dry deck. They were hoping with a bit of rain at Hastings, which never eventuated, and it was 1,400 metres where she had that rain-affected track a few weeks later at the Naki, which we saw on Saturday, and she got the job done. We'll see the speed rating and the figures when we assess ladies' man's chances in the metric mile later in the show, but she's right on song. In fact, in terms of her domestic performances, her Livermore is ranked number one last Saturday, and the Open 14 was ranked number two. So she's right on song to the middle leg next week, and then obviously defending her crown in the Livermore in a few weeks' time.
Yep, she's right in that. She has to be with her genuine Group 1 form here in New Zealand and, of course, with how she's performed out of Australia. All right, before we crack into it, let's go and have a look back last week with things that might have been just a touch bizarre.
Spready. Where are you going?
I'm trying to hide.
What are you hiding for? Just won the race.
What are you talking? No.
Oh, yeah. Next joke. It's a Tui billboard. What's the plan now? I mean, you've won a good race here.
I'm thinking about haste.
You need to tell him that you played polo with Prince Charles.
Yeah, well, King Charles now, I suppose. Hey?
Great story, Tony. I love that sort of stuff. What a mate. You're a winner here as well, too, mate.
If this was the NRL and you were a Newcastle Knights supporter, you'd probably be going home by now. Unlike the Warriors faithful, up the Waz.
I caught up with Lee Thinnes last night at the Warriors game, Brendan, and it was general consensus of the room that we all look forward to Leith Innes's speed map.
Yeah, thanks, George. You're the one who was on the orange juice last night. I think you might be better to do it.
I was drinking orange juice. I don't know what he was drinking, but it was, wasn't the same orange juice as what I was on.
Hammy late. He's in front, though, on the inside, on the outside. Can't quite get him. Yep, he'll win on the inside here.
Tell Leith that I'm also still waiting for my how the horses will settle on the in the Great Northern Steeplechase.
Speed map.
The speed map.
Yeah.
Yep.
It's coming.
It's coming.
Yeah.
So is Christmas.
Yes, there's some very bizarre things going on there from last week. So, yeah, nicely put together, team. And, I guess maybe we're still waiting for Leith Innes's speed map as well, guys.
Well, forget about the speed map. Forget about what George and Leith were drinking. What were you drinking?
a rather hot cup of coffee just pre-race. It was a touch overdone.
Yeah, well, I thought, yeah, we saw you say, I think you said... Wow,
up
that's hot.
I think I said up the wires. That's what I said. All right, let's go and have a look now at our maiden of the week. But boy, it could be plural here with a lot of horses that were good over the last 7 days. Going to take you back to a horse pretty keen to identify because this horse is potentially a very good horse and is at the top of a lot of markets. Her name is Molly Bloom. This race, you would have had sweaty palms watching this race, because I did. Got three back the fence and just had to wait for the right run, but boy, did she explode and put this race away. She looked very good through her trials. Of course, bounced out of that particular race, that Justa Floozy orchestral race, where she was very good. Second horse should be winning next time to the races and Smashing Sister. But as I said, Stephen, that was good along with Adam I Am, Valentine, Matawai on the same day, Danjuro winning yesterday. There's a lot of horses to identify as maiden winners.
We're going to get that this time of the year, aren't we, BP? There's going to be a stack of these maiden races if it's three-year-old or just clear out maiden for the older horses. But yeah, look, on Molly Bloom first. Look, she's always been touted ever since she made her debut last season as a two-year-old. We're all waiting for her to resume as a three-year-old. She had three-year-old written all over her. She's by Ace High. Her second dam's by Generous, which naturally you'd think she's going to get over ground. Are they working back from an Oaks, 1,000 guineas, possibly both? Who knows? She's got extreme talent. You go back to the fourth dam and you'll see an interesting horse by the name of Rough Habit. So, look, she's got pedigree as well, and we know that that family probably hasn't done a huge amount in the last 10, 15, 20 years, but look, they always come back. The family, the bloodlines, they always come back, whether it's a couple of generations away, they always come back, and this might be the one that just reignites that Rough Habit family bloodline. So, you mentioned a few of those other horses that were really impressive. Danjuro, I think he might potentially have one more start at Trentham over 1,400 metres and then be a late target in terms of a 2,000 guineas, but a lot of those answers will be on how he delivers or performs next start to the races. I thought one out of left field was, if you're looking at a horse on the synthetic, was Pukuru Gold out of the Te Aukau barn. Put up a really big number, albeit on the synthetic, so we'll have to replicate that on the turf. But again, that's one horse that really stood up in terms of just on numbers, Pukuru Gold. So it'd be interesting to see where that horse lines up next in the next few weeks or so. But yeah, a really hot week in terms of maiden of the weeks.
But back on that Danjuro, had to fight very, very hard down the straight and got there with the bob of the head. But was it race shape that didn't quite suit, or...?
Oh, look, I think he's a 16-plus metre horse. I think Jonathan Parks has made it clear to us that he could be a Derby-type Danjuro. He's got the pedigree. Look, he's by Saxon Warrior, who's the son of Deep Impact, and Deep Impact are just leaving horses left, right and centre in terms of distance range. I think it comes down to the dam quite often. That's how versatile that Deep Impact line is. So, look, it was very much a sit and sprint race at Woodville yesterday. It probably didn't suit him, but Parksy rode him to a T. He put him in the race just in case it did unfold that way. There didn't look to be a huge amount of speed. Overall, Woodville can play on speed when the track's on a 4 or 5 pentrometer reading, and that's how it unfolded. So, look, I think he'll be a horse better chasing off a solid tempo, and once he gets to 1400, 1600.
Yeah, and I think that race is a good one because you'd have to say Grid Girl is a winner next time to the races, who finished into third position and was scorching home through the line, and even that second placed horse in that particular race. So that is our maidens of the week. Overs gods now, Paul Maoate, we'll leave it with you. What has happened over the last 7 days in terms of our overs gods?
Well, 2 weeks back, they weren't very nice to us at all. But with that away, I think we've seen a turnaround, and certainly if you were back in the overs gods at Riccarton, you were richly rewarded. Let's have a look. Riccarton Race 2, Laddie Flojo, $6 into $2.40. Couldn't quite do it, finished 8th. Race 3 at Riccarton, Pisco Sour, here's one, $12 into $7.50, there's a winner for you. Race 6, Luscious Lover, $18 into $9, another winner. Race 7, The Good Shepherd, $14 into $7.50, finished 9th. Riccarton, Race 10, Naughty But Nice, $6.50 into $2.50, that's a huge go. I can see Steve sweating next to me right now as I mentioned that first. Taranaki Race 4, Iconic Lass, $12 into $6, 4th. Race 7 up at New Plymouth, Sailor Jack, $10 into $3.30, another big go there. Could only manage 7th. Taranaki Race 8, Makushla, $10 into $5, finished 9th. And then on Sunday, Tarapa Race 8, Improview, $12 into $5.50, bang, yes please. And Tarapa Race 9, Sacred Satono. Boy, oh boy, did they come for Sacred Satono. $3.30 into $2. Couldn't quite do it. Second.
It was a good run, Sacred Satono. Ran second. I think the first three are worth following, including...
Who won that race?
Johnny. An old fave here in the leg up. But, yeah, BP, did you have anything on Johnny, or did you just let him alone on the improving track later in the day?
Does the quaddy count? I had him in the quaddy. look, yeah, I will say I was a little bit like that coffee that I had at the beginning of the day. I was a little bit unhappy with myself because I've pretty much backed him every time he's won and not on when he's paid $10. It was a little bit frustrating, but Sacred Satono will keep. Bonnie Lass was very good in that race too, wasn't she? Finishing into third position. Right, let's crack into our race meetings that are coming up over the weekend. And first of all, our group feature is out of Awapuni. Stephen, what's happening in terms of conditions there leading into Saturday's big race day?
Yeah, very tricky, BP. Look, they've had little rain during the week, but there's showers forecasted on race day and potentially heavy rain in the afternoon. So that is a concern. It's a pentrometer reading is 6 at the moment. You'll see there graphically, I think it's updated to a soft 5 in the last hour or so through NZTR. The rail's in the true position, and from memory, if I do check the website, they're using the outside bend, which is quite vital as well. So, look, the last meeting they had at Awapuni BP was back on the 26th of August. The rail was true on that day, but it was a genuine heavy. But I think the talking point is this rain, which is meant to fall tomorrow afternoon.
Okay, so that's going to change a lot in terms of this market, but let's have a look at it now as we chat just after 10 o'clock on Friday morning with where the market does sit. $4.50 for Ladies Man here, Stephen, as the favourite option. What else is happening around this market?
Well, clearly the best bet runner sits with the favourite Ladies Man, 4.5. That is the original price that we set on Wednesday, but accounts for 60% of the hold, does the Alan Sharrock Train Galloper. Cork in that second line at $6 off a shortener of $5.50. Bilardo Boy also out of turn to 6.5. Then you've got this very compressed middle market. Just ask me at 11 with Penny Wecker. Penny Wecker 15 into 11 for now the 4-year-old mare. Kick on 14 to 11, so Penny Wecker and Kick on are the two they've identified in the middle market. Kingfisher Lad 11 out to 12. Sacred Pearl, 14 out to 15 with Calico, Identical, Fluck there. And also Larnacord, 15 out to 16. And I should mention also Platinum Invader has been fairly solid at a $21 price, even though the original quote was $16. So look, overall summary, BP, they're very keen on Ladies Man, even though it's drawn a sticky gate. We'll talk about that more in terms of its chances in the next 5 to 10 minutes. But at a $4.50 quote at this stage, I don't think the traders will be drifting that price anytime soon.
All right, well, let's have a look at Ladies Man. Last time to the races, we only have to go back to last weekend when the horse finished into second position behind Group 1 performer, and that being Mustang Valley, and also Just Ask Me in this particular race. Stephen, what I will say is that he looks to be progressing and heading in the right direction, and even if that rain does arrive, it's going to put him in that right spot.
Look, I would have had him a lot shorter if he had drawn a gate, but we'll just see how the race day unfolds. And we've got an opportunity with that. We know this is in the back third of the day, and we spoke about the rain 5 minutes ago. It is meant to hit. It depends how much rain we do get and how much that track gets affected. But look, he's very versatile, Ladies Man. He can operate on a 5 or 6. If we get into that 8 or 9 pentrometer reading, no knock on him, and maybe that draw becomes less problematic for Michael McNabb. You just look at that figure, all he needs to do is replicate what he did last Saturday and behind Mustang Valley. It rated through the roof, 4.5 lengths above the class rating. Look, you look at his last 600 metres, only 3 horses broke 37 seconds. He was one of those 3 horses. And his last 4 and 200 metre splits were the quickest of the meeting, Ladies Man. That's how well he was going at the back end of the race, off a very solid tempo. Now, he's backing up within 7 days. He's done that on 4 occasions, Ladies Man. Alan Sharrock's asked him to do it on 4 different occasions in his career to date. Out of that 4 occasions, he's won 3 times. 3 times on the 7-day backup. That is crucial if you're wanting to back Ladies Man on the 7-day backup. He is a horse that has done it and done it many times when asked to do it. I think that's a key stat around it. Around the map, look, I think there's enough tempo in the race. We know he's going to be back in the last third, BP. You've got Sweet Janine, She'll Be Rocking, Kingfisher Lad, who's drawn a decent alley, will want to hold a spot. And Kahu Rock from a wide gate will go forward as well. So I've got this race running above tempo to the 600, which is going to favour those horses that are going to be in the second half of the field.
Yeah, Paul, Just Ask Me is a horse that delivered what probably one of the wins of the winter when winning the Opanaki Cup 3 starts ago. He was working home. He's finished into fourth position. He's a horse that will love some rain falling if it eventuates that way. How do you rate his chances coming into this race off the back of that run and maybe a couple of other horses in the race?
Look, he never puts in a poor performance, even though he's usually carrying north of 60 kilos, and he gets that again this Saturday in the Metric Mile. I really do. I'd like to make a case for him. I know he's sort of drifted slightly with the bookies, 10s out to 11s. But I saw enough in that run in behind Ladies Man and Mustang Valley to suggest to me that he's ready to have another go. And with the rain that is forecast, that brings him right into it for mine as well. So
Can he turn the tables on Ladies Man? Because you look at the weights, Ladies Man drops a couple of kegs, and then you've got a horse like Just Ask Me, unable to claim, or they haven't opted for the claim, and he's having to carry 1 kilogram more than what he did last Saturday. So there's like a 3kg swing in favour of Ladies Man, which is going to make his case very hard to turn the tables on number 5, the stablemate.
He does get a bit of a swing to the positive against the likes of Bilardo Boy and Corkui.
In the Winter Cup.
Yes, okay. Yeah. So look, he's got a heart the size of Teddy.
He's a hard horse to place. Well, I think his one race this campaign, if variables work out, is the Livermore. I'm not sure he can beat Mustang Valley, because Mustang Valley can operate, and I'm talking about if there's a wet track. If we get a wet track like we got 12 months ago, he can run a top 3 like he did 12 months ago. I'm not sure he can beat Mustang Valley on a wet track, but that may be his race where he can run in a Group 1, take some prize money. He'll be suited at weight for age. That's the one weights and measures conditions of a race which suits him now. He's very hard to place in these handicap races, particularly if you can't claim in these features. So I think they'll be praying that the rain can stick around for a couple more weeks heading into the Livermore, where he can be in a top 3 chance, and maybe Mustang Valley has an off day. But I'm just not sure about him in this race. And well, he may start now because we're getting this rain. There was talk about during the week that if they weren't going to get the rain and it was going to stick around that 5 or 6 penetrometer reading, Ellen might scratch him and just wait for the Livermore and pray for a rain dance. But yeah, not for me again. Like I wanted to lay him last Saturday, got the result, and I'll be doing the same on Saturday.
Oof. Let's have a look at the first stakes race of the new racing season, and it pretty much does pave a path for many here to say they can be a chance off the back of this Winter Cup. Of course, you've got Bilardo Boy, who wins this particular race, and other key contenders. I think Cork falls into that category, and rain comes about. I think that brings her right into the race. Kick On, who finishes 5th and Just Ask Me, into 4th position. Feel as though we can leverage off this form, Stephen. This is a race that we can certainly identify as a key chance, and I am liking Cork out of this race to say that she can be a chance, even though she hasn't had a start since this day.
Yeah, well, I think, again, a lot of these prices around Cork, Bilardo Boy, are going to be determined of how this track comes back, if we get rain, etc. So in terms of a whole, like the Winter Cup, it does need to improve around really around about 2.5 lengths to measure to what Ladies Man performed last Saturday and behind Mustang Valley. So I'm not sure if it's the right form line to beat Ladies Man, but to finish into the top 4 or 5, yeah, I'm giving the race enough credit, particularly if we see a similar track conditions with rain, because that was a genuine heavy down at Riccarton, and at the moment we're looking at a 6, so it's all very much up in the air how we can compare Riccarton to what is going to unfold tomorrow at Alpony. But look, that race shape did suit a lot of those horses that came from midfield, finished over the top of them, the likes of Cork, Bilardo Boy, Just Ask Me, even Kick On. They went very hard in the Winter Cup. I think roughly to the 600 was rated 8.5 lengths above class. So it really did suit those horses that stalked the speed and charged down the centre of the track. So, look, but we could get a similar race shape tomorrow, as we've spoken about. So, look, they're worthy contenders, but I just feel that Ladies Man, from what I've seen in recent times, and I'm talking about last Saturday, compared to the Winter Cup, where a lot of those horses had their last run, I'm in the Ladies Man camp.
Seems like Paul, the only negative for Ladies Man is the car park, which is where he's drawn.
And that could be a positive. It's hard to assess. But again, we've got Michael McNabb services. He'll be able to adjust and see how the track's playing, how it's unfolding. Even if he finds a 3-wide train, worse than midfield, and he's got the speed, Ladies Man, to put himself in the race at a vital part. If they lack the tempo roughly between the 1,600 metre mark, I'm sure Michael can ask Ladies Man to put himself in the race and be within 2 or 3 lengths coming the business end of the race, the home turn.
All right, Paul, we'll bring you in here and have a look at a video of Lana Cord when finishing into 2nd position, because this was her first up run. Look, she's a more than capable mare. There has been sprinkling in that middle sort of market where she sits at $15. You've also got the runner in Sweet Janine in this race, who is the likely leader, as we spoke about, who finishes into 3rd position, and Sacred Pearl, who runs 4th. Your thoughts around, first of all, Lana Cord, Paul?
Yeah, I thought Lana Cord, I thought her run here was super. Fresh up, and I think she'll be a lot better for that. And I can see why she's fairly solid in that sort of mid-teen market, $15, $16. So certainly if you're looking at your first 4s, I think you've got to include her in there somewhere. In terms of Sweet Janine, she's just a wee bit cold with the bookies at the moment, so they just... It's a wee bit of a concern for mine. I would have thought if connections were keen on her chances, we might have seen a wee bit more sort of action her way. So she's 18 out to 26 as we speak. But certainly Lana Cord off that fresh up run. Looks like Stephen has got her very, very well set for the season.
Yeah, look, there's a horse I want to show you, and it's out of the Group 1. And it's Penny Wecker. I think probably what this video doesn't do justice for her is what you need to see after the line. If you can get hold of that steward's vision on loveracing.nz, it's all good vision watching what she does past the line and through the line. We know that she's a horse that's going to be better once she gets beyond 1600 metres. She's an Oaks winner on both sides of the Tasman at Group 1 level. Just wonder how ready she's to go second up here, Stephen, off the back of this run. I'm prepared to say she can be a decent chance. She's 15s into 11s. Any rain's not going to be an issue for her. We probably don't see it on this vision here, but she right here. There she is there in the lime green, hustling underneath runners off that drone vision. Very good vision to be able to try and get, if you can look at it on Love Racing, in terms of that steward's vision. So she was eye-catching late, Stephen. How much of a chance?
Big chance. Big chance. She's got that X factor. She could win this race and put two lengths on them, and no one would be surprised. She's a dual Group 1 winner, Oaks winner here and across the Tasman. Look, the Tarzino, it's just a total forgive. It was never her setup. The market identified that. I think she was 30-plus in terms of final field odds. There was always support for her with the big syndicate. But realistically, 1,400 metres, they ran 123 and change. That's not her going a decent track at Hastings. 1,600 metres and back to handicap conditions. With the presence of Just Ask Me, she's beautifully placed in the weights. What is she? She's 2.5 kgs off the minimum. For a dual Group 1 winner, albeit against her own age last season, she's perfectly placed here. And as you've mentioned, any rain is not a negative. She won on Livermore last year, on a genuine heavy track, and she placed in a Desert Gold at Trentham on an off track. Any rain brings a rider contention, because it will be a true 1600 metre race. She's single figures SP tomorrow, there's no doubt about that. She was well overs at 15s, and punters have identified that.
Love Penny Wicker. Absolutely love it. I think that was a fantastic run in the Tarzino. The step up to the 1600 will suit her to a T. Any rain, fantastic. Just keen to see what Jim Wallace and the team have got sort of planned out for Penny Wicker for the rest of the season.
I think Australia beckons, doesn't it, for Penny Wicker. Quickly wrap it up, boys. Your thoughts around the race and how you see it panning out.
Look, I love Penny Wicker at the price. Even though she's come in from 15 to 11, obviously there's a bit of support from her big syndicate. But the $11 doesn't turn me away. So, yeah, I love Penny Wicker each way. I've got a soft spot for Just Ask Me. I think we may see him pop up here unexpectedly, and then Ladies Man, of course.
Yeah, I'm a Ladies Man, BP. I just can't get away from that performance last Saturday. He's proven on the 7-day back up, $4.50. I reckon he starts closer to $3.04, and the other value in the race, and it's already been snapped up 15 to 11. We've spoken about this progressive four-year-old mare and Penny Wicker. She starts single figures tomorrow afternoon.
Yeah, pretty keen to have a split bet myself, and it involves Penny Wicker. I think she's a horse that's worth taking some of that $11 now, because there's a high chance if that rain does arrive that she doesn't start at $11 and will be in the single figures. And Ladies Man is that other horse looking to take the split bet with. That is the Hunterville Vet Club Metric Mile, our feature coming up on the weekend, Group 3 over 1,600 metres. Hey, I got a lot of faith in you. I'll stick with you, kid, that's the bottom. Time for the Lance O'Sullivan Award, and this is one thing that Lance never achieved in his fantastic career, and that was a jumping winner. So we're going to go for this week's Lance O'Sullivan Award to Aaron Kudu. Now, this is the win aboard Ned Wynn. I thought a super ride by Aaron. He nailed the program with this particular ride aboard Ned Wynn. He spoke about wanting to be in a closer position to English Gambler. English Gambler was always going to be that horse who was going to be in front, and he made sure, from learning from 3 weeks ago when beaten in the Pakaranga, that was in a right position and then went for gold down the back straight, really opened the field up. Yes, he carried a lot of weight, and then Tahereau Height was stalking him behind, but he was just the tough right galloper to be able to do exactly what he did. Aaron assessed it nicely, and he got the job done. So it was a super ride by Aaron in the Great Northern Hurdles when taking it out aboard Ned Wynn. Well, I know I had it coming. I know I can't be free. For Maoate, who was doing hard time?
Well, let's have a look at Zyla, let's have a look at the start first, because boy, oh boy, we're going to the rodeo to start with, right out the back. No chance of winning here whatsoever. And just look at the way. We just finish off here down the outside into second. Some very, very sharp sectionals. I think the fastest last 6.42. Maybe one to get on next time. And hopefully we get away without the rodeo show. Hard
Amazing
time.
Run. Amazing run, Paulie, too, because this horse is a wet tracker. I mean, this horse is showing all its best form on wet ground. That track was starting to quicken up by the time that race came around. So, yeah, well identified. That was quite an incredible run from that horse. All right, it was doing hard time. We need to press on and have a look at our next race. And it is back at Awapuni, and it is the open handicap race number 6 over 1,200 metres. Darcy LaBella comes up as the favourite at 270. She's second up, of course, her defeat in the Foxbridge Plate here, Stephen. And Old Town Road is hovering at $3.60.
Yeah, Darcy LaBella, big drop back in grade, a slight freshen up. The Alan Sharrock team opened $3 on Wednesday, BB. It's been backed into 270. A lot of that action has been from the opening whistle on Wednesday right up to Friday morning. It counts at roughly 85% of the halter. It's almost one-way traffic around the mare Darcy LaBella. In front of Old Town Road at 360 off a shortener of 3.5. A Wild Moose resumes here for the latter team, 750 out of turn to 8. Is that so? 10 into 850, so firmer there around number 7. Is that so? A Sanibel $11, a Rain It In $13, Pull No Punches $14, a Deerfield at $15, and Tabby Court, a recent winner, two back at 21 off a shortener of 18. So, as I mentioned, one-way traffic. It sits with number 1, Darcy LaBella.
Yeah, she looks a good bet. She looks a cracking bet there. I thought on the weekend she gets 4 kilos off with Tony Davies aboard to bring her back to 58 kilograms. She's 3 from 3, second up. And this was her first up performance in beat, and when beaten in, look, the hot race, the Foxbridge Plate. Genuine Group 1 form out of this race with the Quinella in different order in the Tarzino. So it's hard form to ignore, Stephen, isn't it, when you see this with Darcy LaBella and her wet track performances. If the rain comes, well, she probably only just shortens up further in the market.
Absolutely. And you just got to trust the stable. Look, they weren't happy with that performance. They bypassed the Tarzino. This is where Alan's so astute. Yeah, the horse comes first. He just wanted to take care of the horse. There's a long season ahead. There'll be other Group 1s to target later on the season when she's A-OK, Darcy LaBella. She's had a jump out in the interim, I think from memory, on Monday, which apparently she performed very well in winning. And again, you just got to look for that initial support from the Alan Sharrock barn. It's there, $3.270. It's what we call smart money here at headquarters. Where her price ends up, I'm not 100% sure, but 270, in terms of weight of money, still represents value, but that can change as the market develops between now and race start. But look, the only concern is probably the map. Best outcome would be possibly just worse to midfield, find that three wide train with a little bit of cover. She is adaptable, she does have tactical speed, but from that wide gate I just feel they'll be a little bit neutral and just try and find that cover and get her in that position there. There does seem to be enough speed in the race with Deerfield. Wherever there's a race and you find Deerfield in, well, you know it's going to be a genuine tempo for at least the first 400 to 600 metres. Old Town Road's drawn a sticky gate, should come forward. And is that so? And Wild Moose have tactical speed from an inside gate. So I think overall they'll go steady enough, which will help the favourite.
All right, Paul, bring you in here around one of the key, probably other chances in the race away from Darcy LaBella, and it's this race here, the Tavy Court race, when Tavy Court was able to beat home Old Town Road. What are we taking out of this? Are the dangers out of this race to Darcy LaBella?
Yeah, I certainly think Old Town Road is the main danger to Darcy LaBella, and he'll appreciate any rain that may come as well. I think if you wait until late tomorrow, you may get a nice little price on Old Town Road, who finishes off nicely here into third place, I think. Just with the sort of action that the boys are taking on Darcy LaBella, don't see that sort of tapering off anytime soon. And as such, I think we'll see a wee bit of a drift on Old Town Road. And I think if he gets out towards $4, I think he's definitely worth a wee bit of a go. So yeah, the main danger, and I think Lily will be able to get him across up towards close to the lead, and yeah, he may get away with one here.
Yeah, and look, he gets a great swing in the weights too on Tavy Court from that particular race. That's the one thing that's in his favour. Old Town Road, a couple of kilos off with Lily aboard, 54 kilos. Wet track's not going to be an issue if we get into beyond 7. He has to be the major danger to the favourite in Darcy LaBella. What about Wild Moose? Now, Steve, when we go back to the Foxton trials recently for this good galloper, he's won 4 from 13. He's a horse that has been able to perform first up. This is his Foxton trial at the end of August.
he led in this trial. He stacked them up just coming around the turn here and then kicked late to win in a time of 1:04. Look, he's a six-year-old, only having start number 14, so he's had the odd issues under the latter care, but he's just shown, he's always shown immense ability. He's always won or been surrounded by some very good horses. So it's just a matter of where he is fitness. I doubt they want the track to deteriorate too much because he'll be presented first up, and if we get in that eight range, it will really affect him in terms of fitness levels. There's nothing better when you get a horse on an eight to have race day fitness v trials or jump outs, and that might be the one hurdle that he may face. He maps very well. He's got a strong SP profile when you go back to last campaign. And he's got the services of Jonathan Riddell, which I'm sure they'll use the gate. He's got tactical speed, which we saw in the trial. You can take trials, you know, with a little bit of salt. But I mean, I think in general, you look back at his career, he's always shown tactical speed, and he'll be able to use that with Riddell aboard. The only concern is how this track's going to play in terms of rainfall tomorrow afternoon.
Lisa Ladder's been going very, very well. She'll have him ready to go.
Well, you know, you can have a horse ready to go, but it's like any athlete. It's a rugby player needs rugby. You can train on the field as much as you can, and it's similar with horses. And when you get to a track that's off, it really is hard to get that fitness into them, which is required to operate on an eight or a nine, which, again, we're
if there's no rain.
Well, if there's no rain, he's right in it. He's right in it. He's got as much ability as anything in the horse, anything in the race, excluding probably Darcy Labella, who is the number one seed in terms of what she's performed in the last 12 months. But, yeah, he's a hard horse to assess and where his SP lies purely because he's one horse that's dictated so much by the rain or the track conditions of what's going to unfold.
Sean Johnson didn't look too bad fresh up last weekend, to be fair.
No, he's up pretty good. Looked very good, didn't he, considering he had a little bit of a calf issue.
And
was still able to hoof the ball upfield in the last, about 75 minutes. I actually really like the Quinella. I think the fixed Quinella, Darcy Labella and Old Town Road, currently $5.40. I think if conditions become suitable for both those horses, they look to be a nice play, and Darcy Labella could possibly even get shorter if the rain does fall. That is race number 6 on the program out of Awapuni, set down and start at 3:43.
We're back for another minute with Maoate, and this time I'm joined by Jess Allen. Jess, thanks for coming along to have a chat.
Thanks for having me. I probably would have went to university and worked at the dairy factory, done what my mum does. Used to Be Young by Miley Cyrus. Probably me. I'm a beginner, so I'm unorganised.
Still finding your way.
Yeah. Probably, marathon running, is that at the Olympics?
Yeah, long distance, yeah.
Yeah,
there's quite a few jockeys are marathon runners. Have you run long distance before?
I trained for a marathon, but I never got to do it because of COVID. Oh. Touch wood, I actually haven't...
Not yet.
I haven't had too bad a spray. I'm pretty hard on myself though, so if that counts from me. Probably Kai and Johnny at Pukekohe, yeah. Probably Vin Diesel. I used to really like the Fast and Furious movies. I can make this noise.
I did not expect that.
Oh no, I didn't have one. Oh, I can do the splits. Oh, I'm not doing it now. I can't do it in these. But
right.
When I'm drunk, I can do the splits. How you doing?
Joey, come on.
Jess Allen there, not showing us her best dance moves, but also throwing out a few pickup lines here on the leg up. Good fun, riding well as well, team. It looks like you had some fun there when you were able to catch up with the jockeys, Paulie.
Oh, they're a great bunch of people, the jockeys, who, if they're not winning, can sometimes be maligned by a few people. But I guess the sort of effort that they put in and the sort of strains that they put their bodies under, they're fair dinkum athletes. So, yeah, good on them. And, how are you doing?
Yeah, I'm doing good, thanks. Joey / Paul, let's move on, shall we, rather quickly, and have a look at Tauranga for our next live race, our next race we want to preview. First of all, Stephen, conditions for our race meeting out of Tauranga.
Yeah, again, tricky to assess, BP. Very much a like of Alperni with his rain forecasted on race days. You see there graphically a soft five. They've had no rain in the last 7 days at Tauranga. And the rail was in the true position. So early doors, naturally we suggest on speed. But again, the big talking point is how much rain they're going to get on race day and when that pentrometer gets to. But at the moment it's on a five currently, BP.
Let's go to race number three. This is a hot three-year-old race. The ultimate Mazda three-year-old, Lupo Sotario, 2.30. Stephen versus What You Wish For, $2.50. How's the betting, first of all, around these two runners?
Matching dollar for dollar. No lead, 3v1. Lupo Sotario, 2.30. What You Wish For at 2.50. Again, that's the original prices. And slotter number seven, My Lips Are Sealed, also matching dollar for dollar versus the three and the one at a $6 price. Then you've got the second division, led by Quirky Habits at $15, Lot Katrine also at $15, and best of the rest is Tears of Victory at an $18 price. So, look, overall summary, no clear lead, but matching dollar for dollar is the top three in the market, Lupo Sotario, What You Wish For, and My Lips Are Sealed.
You in here, this was a very good win from a horse that was identified in this race. It should really hold up as a leading form reference. We've seen what Mary Shan come out of this race and be placed in Charms of Farm. Good win.
That was a very good win. What I liked so much about this race, BP, and we did just missed it at roughly around about the 500 metre mark, the horse was positioned midfield rail. In a couple of bounds, it found itself in midfield rail to fourth outer and challenging the lead. Just that acceleration the horse showed in a telling part of the race, and then came down the centre part of the straight and put that, what we say is a tidy field, to bed. And I think the jockey was fairly softened in the last 50 metres, Lupo Sotario.
Oh, he had a handful.
Yeah, he did, yep. There's no doubt about it. I think if a horse ranged up in or out, there was a bit more to offer on the horse. Look, it's a new challenge. On Saturday, first time right-handed in terms of race day. Look, he's trialled right-handed, but Tauranga can be a bit of a tricky place if you had never raced there prior. It can be a bit of a horse for course. He's up against race winners, which we know that was a maiden race at Tarapa. So it's a new acid test for the horse, but there's no doubt he's got huge ability. And there's been some decent offers on this horse, which they've turned down because they're working back from a Karaka Classic at the back end of January.
All right, let's have a look at What You Wish For here, Paulie. This is a horse that I know has impressed many close to the camp. His first two runs as a two-year-old. He's come back and he's been beaten by Solidify, but he was charging late. He's a horse I know that's, you know, near the top end of the 2,000 guineas markets as well. Your thoughts on him?
Yeah, no shame in getting beaten by Solidify. And, well, they had the number, the ace draw here, I'm fairly sure. And Opie went back on What You Wish For. As you say, just turned in a nice finishing burst there. I don't know if we're getting value at 250. I think we've got the Opie factor and the Tiakau factor working against us here. So, look, I really do like the one at the top there, Lupo Sotario, but there's certainly no qualms about What You Wish For. That was a super run.
I'm not sure about that race, BP. It rated a fraction below par, 1.4.
Didn't you? You spoke about that last time, didn't you, Stephen, about how that Quintessa race that day was rated a lot better than that one.
Yeah, I think from memory, three lengths above what Solidify performed. Solidify, I thought, was just fair in the Meads Trophy at Hastings. His next start, he finished fifth midfield, well and truly beaten by Tokyo Tycoon. Discovery Bay finished well back in the meets, who finished third in that race. You line it up with the Quintessa form line. It was no match for that race on the same meeting. The overall speed rating was 1.5 lengths below par. So I'm just not sure what to make of. What I will say, though, when it came down to What I Wish For, there was a lack of money at Taupo to suggest that it's got a lot more improvement in it. And with Opie jumping on, it would only need to improve one or two lengths and it could put this field to bed. So just take note, there was a bit of trepidation in the marketplace, suggests it was a run short at Taupo and there would be natural improvement because, as we know, that stable, they identify grand finals and the grand final could be down at Riccarton in a few weeks' time. So look for natural improvement, which we'll have to because it's got some decent challenges on Saturday.
Let's have a look at the three-odd filly in the race, and that is My Lips Are Sealed. This horse produced a really good win. when beating Monday Melody on this occasion. Now, this is on a very wet surface. What was it, rated a heavy 10 on this occasion, for my lips are sealed. Look, it's a runner that we have to respect here, Stephen, and probably the next best away from those two at the top of the market. Would you agree on that?
I think she's the value in the race. I priced her closer to $5 than $6 where she's trading at the moment. I loved her first up win here at Avondale when beating a smart one. The speed rating was 3.6 lengths above the class. There were three 1,200 metre maiden events that day. Her race ranked number one. I think Warren has options from that draw too, Warren Kennedy. I think depending on tempo, he's got options. He can stalk if it's a slow tempo. If it's a hard tempo, he might just have to bustle her to hold a position. But from that draw, he has options, Warren Kennedy. And no rain. I mean, if no rain is there, that's a slight question mark, but I think she's a horse. Look, she's by ace high. Naturally, I think they'll be versatile in any track conditions. But she is one horse that is proven on a heavy track, which we just saw there graphically, if the rain does come. So she's a little bit bulletproof there on track conditions. As I say, I marked her roughly around about a 20% chance. So that $5 price line compared to where she's trading at $6 looks a little bit overs. And I think she's the one for value if I'm comparing her to the two favourites who are trading at 230 and 250.
Okay, Paul, we want to have one look at one more video, and it's a video around Tears of Victory. Now, this is a video where Tears of Victory actually comes underneath Valentine, and Valentine was a very good winner on Wednesday, just gone out of Matamata Maria Sense and rides again. It's a horse who was punched forward and was put into the race and got the right sort of run. A contender for trying to find trifecta first four chances?
Oh, I think so. You definitely got to include her. Look, she sat in behind the lead here, as you say, in behind Valentine. The gap opened up and she just cruised through along the rail there. And I think she was at some pretty juicy odds that day as well. And we're still getting some fairly nice odds on her at the moment, $18. So I think if you're looking for a top three or a top four who may upset those three runners at the top of the market, I think you've got to include Tears of Victory. That was a super run. With Maria Sanson on, she gets 3 kilos off. So she's
She leads here too.
She's getting 5 kilos off those ones at the top of the market.
Yep, I think she leads, which could be handy. No disadvantage to Tauranga. The figure was okay. She probably on that score alone, what we saw at Matamata, she needs to improve at least 2.5 lengths to match the top two in the market, even the third line favourite. Yeah, but again, she puts herself in the race, which is always a positive. SPs, when you're on debut, doesn't really mean much. I don't put a huge amount of weight into that, even though she, I think, SP'd at roughly around about $20-odd when winning at Matamata. When they're exposed for the very first time, it's almost irrelevant.
30.
So, yeah, I mean, $18 second up. Yeah. I don't know if she's a massive firmer, because I think those top three are going to be rock solid in the market. I don't think there's going to be too many drifting markedly to make those outsiders firm in. But, yeah, look, I think she's a horse that could give them a fright down the straight purely on how she maps.
All right, 3:30 on the Quinella, the fixed Quinella on the two favourites there, and what you wish for in Lupo Solitario. I don't think there's much between them. It really doesn't look to be much between them, and maybe you could go with Lupo there, who is the current favourite at $2.30. Let's have a look at another feature on the programme there at Tauranga. It's the Open 1400. Bell of the Ball, $2.70, and Gosh Bottom at around $3.60, who has had both those horses have had support, Stephen.
Yeah, Gosh Bottom was the best back runner after 24 hours BP, $3.60 off a peak of four. But just in recent times, Thursday evening and Friday morning, Bell of the Ball, clearly the best back runner, holds two times more money than Gosh Bottom, $3 and $2.70. So they're identifying at the point end of the market, punters, Bell of the Ball and Gosh Bottom, your two firmers there. Fontaine and Dusty Road, $6.50 each of two. Digger at $7 and Crystallised Best of the Rest at $10. But punters pretty happy to snap up the one and the five and the five and the one.
Paul, bring you in here around Bell of the Ball. This was her first up run when finishing into fourth position. She was up against the rail. She can perform second up, and the money has come for the horse.
Yeah, and rightly so too. Found a wee bit of trouble, struggled to get a sort of running room when she really needed it. But when she did, she looked very, very good. Warren Kennedy jumps on. They've got an ideal draw from the three gate. Money's on already, $3 and $2.70. I think a lot of positives here around Bell of the Ball.
Yep. Stephen, I think the clear other horse that we probably think about in this race has got a spot. A runner that's beaten in the Fox Bridge, beaten in the Tarzino. Yes, he's got to carry some weight because he's earned it and he's in a handicap race and they're not claiming, but Opie is aboard.
He's got a few positives. Again, if there was any rain around, it wouldn't knock him, but it's always hard to carry a big weight on a rain-affected track, but does have the surfaces as Opie. Well, there's one horse I'm interested in if the rain does come, and that's number 7, Dusty Road. He showed enough as a 3-year-old BP. I think you had a little bit of time for him at different stages in his 3-year-old prep. The stable thought, well, regarded highly enough to put him in a Wellington Guineas from memory or a Living Classic, one of those two races, at the back end of his campaign. So, look, his trial was very good. It's an interesting stage to bring him back. Maybe they're thinking that he can operate on better tracks because as we get further on, these tracks are going to dry up. But first up, if there was any rain round, he's proven on that surface he might be a bet and really challenge these top two in the market.
Yeah. I think so. I think if that rain does arrive, he does become a bet, Dusty Road. This is the horse when trialling up recently out of Te Awamutu, and it was a good trial from him. Any rain brings him right into this race. He's more than capable, this horse. Judging off how he won his couple of races and what he was able to do last season, I certainly do believe he's a horse that can work his way through the grades. And they're testing the water here. There's a horse has had just 9 starts and 2 wins in the open handicap over the 1,400 metres. Just quickly, boys, your thoughts, your final thoughts on the race?
Oh, I'm going to the top of the market, bell of the ball. I'm very, very keen on how she'll go. I think from that gate, Warren Kennedy will be able to dictate terms, and I really do like the look of it. Yeah, it was a great run for 4th fresh up.
Yeah, she looks well placed for a rating 83 and sits on the minimum of 54. Dusty Road, definitely want to include it if the rain comes. He's got an 8kg swing or advantage over the toppy, which I know he's got wet track credentials in Gespotten, but it's very hard to carry 62 on a wet track. So I'd probably be clearing away from him and go with Bella the Bull and Dusty Road.
Yeah, I think Dusty Road could be a nice little value play if that rain does fall. That is a look at Tauranga, race number 4 on the program there on a good day of racing. That 4th is set down to start at 2:48. Well, it's time to put a bit of Marvin Gaye on in the background and bring us the foreplay team. What have we got, Paul? I'll start with myself, actually. We'll go with Cylinder in the Golden Rose top 4 at $1.45. What have you got for us, Paul?
I'm heading to the NRL and I'm going easy. Panthers to win against the Melbourne Storm, $1.20.
I'll go to Tauranga, race 3, the 3-year-old 1,300. My lips are sealed. I just feel Warren's got options from that map. She showed enough in her maiden victory in terms of a speed rating. Top 4 at $1.35.
Fad's not here, but he's gone with the alternate point start. Wales plus 7.5 against the Wallabies, who are in all sorts. That's $1.33. Now, we've already put the $100 bonus bet on. And so if all of those 4 legs come through, it's a $212 return. All you have to do is head to the TAB Facebook page and answer the leg up question. It'll be there in the next hour or so. And then you'll go in the draw. And then if those 4 legs come in, it'll be $212 transferred to your TAB account. So make sure you've got a TAB account, because if you don't, it'll probably go to Thad's TAB account. Nobody wants that.
Come on. Yeah, let's sign up. And if you haven't signed up, there's a great chance. It's a great promo. You get those 10 bonus bets or something. Is it by 10 or something like that? So get involved and sign up today if you want to be part of that particular bet type there. Right, let's have some best bets for you. But before we do that, let's recap last week. Let's get straight to it. Tavernia, for me, in race number 3, over 1,200 metres.
Tavernia up the middle, decision time, Pisco Sour, plenty of chances, Pisco Sour's arriving, the inside Spartan, Pisco Sour, the number one son in Spartan, it's going to be close, they hit it, Pisco Sour, 1.5 head, Pisco Sour beats Spartan, third, I think, Tavernia.
Paul. continue your winning form. You're storming into the 40% ROI. What's your best bet this weekend?
I'm sticking with the Walker Burgesson dynamic duo.
Found a niche here.
Yeah, and I love the look of Star of Justice.
Star of Justice with the blinkers on. She exploded away. 4 to 5 lengths in front, running on an afternoon delight from Shindo and Bornholm. But it's all Star of Justice she trotted in.
You'll go to Sunday, race 5, the open mile. Turn the Ace.
Turn the Ace all flat out now. Powwow's having another dig on the outside, getting close too. Powwow put its bib in front from Turn the Ace, and Powwow annoyed the favourite out of it. Powwow will beat Turn the Ace.
So there's one winner in there. Nice work, Paulie, finding your one at a good price and a couple of placings from the team. Gee, my one never travelled the whole entire race and still actually ran third to Vernier. And you were bombed there late, Stephen, with Turn the Ace. So we'll start with our best bets for this week. And I'm going to go with a horse that's running in the very first race at Tauranga by the name of Knowledge is Power. This horse trialled up like a bomb at Te Awamutu. Hopefully that the two-year-old form can roll into two-year-old trial form can roll into his very first race day start. The Sun of Written Tycoon, Opie aboard. Look, it is pretty much just a little punch to the covers because it is paying only $1.80, but we'll try and get things rolling with that horse.
Yeah, I'll go to Tauranga Race 3, the three-year-old 1,300-metre race, and I love the look of Lupo Solitario. They got on the first start, and he did the business. I see no reason why he doesn't do that again. That was a super, super effort by Lupo Solitario. In that first up win. I think Ryan Elliott does it again. Might need to ask for a wee bit more, but I think he can do it.
You'll go to Alpuni, race 5 from memory, or race 3, should I say. The rating 65, 1100 metres. Idyllic, progressive 5-year-old mare. He's only had the 5 starts to date, but a lot of positives heading into tomorrow's assignment. She's won both trials leading in. A speedy horse who's drawn barrier 1 with all press to ride. Horse is going to be very hard to catch. Idyllic.
All right, Paulie, before we wrap it up, promos, what have you got for us?
Yeah, we've got the bonus back on Saturday across the 4 meetings. The first 4 races from Tauranga, Awapuni, Rosehill and Caulfield. Run 2nd, 3rd or 4th, get a bonus bet. Up to $50. Just head to the TAB website for all the T's and C's. Don't forget, no deductions, no surprises, all the way till the end of summer. Future proof is on as well, Steve, so if you like your futures markets, you can get stuck in there. Oh, there's plenty going on.
Yeah, there's a lot to look forward to, isn't there, lads? And of course, good racing across the Tasman, the Golden Rose this weekend. Of course, we've got Group 1 racing out of Melbourne also. All right, we better leave it there, team. Thanks for your time as always, Paulie and Hunty. And what's coming up over the weekend for you lads?
Well, there's a game in Brisbane on Saturday night that I'm looking forward to. Up to us!
And Hunty, for you?
Just work, family duties, you know me, BP, very similar to yourself, I'd say.
Oh, too good, too good. All right, well, next Saturday, of course, is the second Group 1 coming out of Hawke's Bay. We'll be looking forward to that. We'll be on track for leg up for that edition next Friday. And I guess we just have to end this program with a very simple message. And you could flavour it a little bit with an expletive if you want to as well, but it's pretty much just as simple as this. Up the Waz. We'll see you next Friday.